following interview was conducted for Eva Goble for the Purdue University Oral History Program. It took place on Friday, January the 5th, 2007, at her place in West Lafayette. The interviewers are Katherine Markee and Valerie Yazza, the Diversity Fellow. Welcome. Can you tell us a little bit about where you were born and a little bit about your family and where you went to early school?
Well, I was born in southern Clay County. And that is the part of the state that has clay soil, which means not very good soil. It was a farm family, and of course, as time went by, the mines came in, because it was mines under that thin soil, coal. And we had an influx of many different kinds of people. So my early school and high school, I went to school with Serbs and Germans and French and people from all over, mostly European, but Southeastern. And we had, I didn't think anything about it. I just thought, that's the people you went to school with. So my folks ran this farm and stayed out of any kind of controversy. They didn't believe in getting in fights. And we had a lot of fights.
What year were you born?
1910.
Okay. Do you want to give us the date?
May 28.
Okay. Do you have any brothers? Do you have any brothers or sisters?
I have an older brother. I had an older brother and a younger brother and sister. And the sister and brother were 10 and 12 years younger than I. So I started taking care of kids pretty early.
You'd say so, right. Were your parents from that area? Were they born and raised there? So the farm had been in the family for quite a while?
The farm would have been in the family for 90 years when I sold them. And somebody said, don't sell them. I said, look, I can't afford it.
Are the coal mines still in operation there?
Yeah. One or two strip mines. Peabody still operates south of there.
Okay. What was it like did you go to, was school close to where you lived? Grade school?
No, I walked a mile or a mile and a half to school. Okay. 12 years.
And where did you go to high school?
Went to high school in Jasonville. And it was a mile and a half. When I had an evening function, I got pretty tired then, because I came home in the dark. But luckily, I had a couple of neighbor boys that usually came with me.
Oh, that was nice. Yeah. When you were in high school, did you belong to any clubs? How large was your high school?
Well, my class, when we graduated, had 36 in it.
Your graduating class had 36?
Yeah.
That's a small school.
It was a little school. But we had a dramatic club that I belonged to, and a Latin club that I belonged to. And aside from that, there wasn't much for young people to do.
What about the library? Did you go to the, was there a library there you could go to?
We didn't have a library. Okay. Well, I helped start the first library. Somebody rented an empty store building and said, if people will bring books, we'll hire somebody to be the librarian. And I carried few books we had.
it's going to take.
Did you participate in any athletics in high school? Or?
I played girls basketball.
Basketball?
Yeah. That was when girls basketball was this way. The guards were back here. The forwards were here. The guards never got the forwards' territory. So you had, if you were a guard, you stayed back here. And if you could shoot a goal, you had to be a good shot because it was quite a long way.
So when you were applying for colleges, where did you apply to?
Well, I went to Indiana State, and I applied and was accepted, and I was there in 1929, I believe, and that's when the banks closed and commerce closed down, everything. It was a time that I can't describe to you because I don't think we've lived through the same thing again. Everybody lost what money they had. If you had money in the bank, you lost it. If you'd borrowed from the bank, you had to pay it.
What do you remember? It says, how did that affect your family?
Well,
they were farming.
Put them out of business, practically.
Did they continue to do some farming?
Continue to live on the farm. My father had a hardware store, and he could make it because the miners were the ones who bought the hardware, and the mines closed down.
Were you able to stay in college though?
No, I came home. And I was at home about, I suppose, 3 months, and I heard of some girls who were going to Anderson, Indiana, which is an automobile-producing place. And I said I'd like to go, too. So they said, come and go. They had found transportation. So we went, and I got a job in a factory putting, I was paid 21 cents an hour, and we stayed at the White BCA, and we wore overalls to work, and I made enough money to get new soles on my shoes.
Were you able to, did you go back to college? Did you graduate from
college? No. I stayed until the factory closed. I had to go home. So, after I got home, the town was full of young people that needed jobs. So we'd all get together and talk about what was possible. And a bunch were going to Hammond. They'd heard that there was employment there. So I said, I wanted to go too. And we went to Hammond. I got a job in a department store selling china and hardware. And I stayed there, I forgot, must have been a year, at Minas department store. I think they're still running. And all the kids in this small town would get together on Saturday night, and we'd talk about who was going to go home. And whoever had a car wanted to fill it up. So we could always get a ride home over the weekend. Kept us kind of in touch with things. So after all, by the way, one of the women of that store invited me to us, and we ate in a mom and pop spaghetti store place, you know. I had spaghetti every night for 29 cents, 25 cents.
That you do not forget.
You know, it tasted pretty good. And, let's see, in Hama, I managed to accumulate a little money, and my father cashed his life insurance, got a loan on it, and owed me $350. And I went back to school and got a two-year license. At that time, you could teach in the country schools if you had a two-year license. So I got a school that was near my grandmother's house, and she rented me a room, and I taught the country school for 4 years.
So how long were you in Hammond?
I think I must have been there about 18 months or so.
And when you were in school, were you in college? Did you get involved in any organizations or activities?
No. Actually, when I was in college, I was just trying to fill out the two-year license. And I didn't bother with anything. And I finally got the license, and I got a school. And those little kids were wonderful. I learned as much from them as they learned from me. And so I taught there 4 years. And then I decided I better start doing something else. So I'd go back to school in the summer, in the summertime, and teach in the wintertime. I think I did that for 6 years.
Did you always know you wanted to be a teacher?
What?
Did you always know you wanted to be a teacher?
I had no idea anything else you could be. You could be a nurse, but a nurse at that time had to go into the hospital and work for her room and board. And that was a tough road. So, that's the way it
did. Did you have any professors that influenced you a lot during those 2 years?
I think during my undergraduate years, I was interested in a class that, well, I was interested in one class that taught government and one class that was economics. And those two things I kind of, I kept on being interested in. And of course, after I got my degree, I taught 4 years, I think, in Brazil in a city system. And had little kids again. Mm-hmm. Used to take them to the gymnasium. It's about a mile away. And they'd walk along, you know, everybody holding hands. And I'd always put a little boy named Bobby in front because he'd forget what he was doing. Bobby would walk along looking, you know, and he fall down and everybody fell on him. They were a great bunch, you know, they just laughed, you know.
So it was quite an experience.
Oh, yeah. Great.
You got your degree from Indiana State?
Yeah.
What was it, 2 years?
Year, 4 year.
Oh, see, but first you got your license and then did you go back?
I've got my 2 year license and my 4 year license. Hmm. And when I got my 4 year license, I talked to an extension agent. And she said, why don't you go up and see Miss Gaddis? I didn't, you know, I was just of the opinion I ought to be looking for something that paid more than $1,000 a year. And I came up to see Miss Gaddis, and she talked to me, and she's very erect, proper person. And she said, what makes you think you can do this job? I said, I've never failed yet. Of course, I'd only had two jobs. Right then, I got it.
So during the first two-year program, did you live at home still, or did you live on campus?
No. I never lived on campus at Indiana State. When I was in Brazil, I drove back and forth, so I commuted. And that was fun, too, because I always had a car load.
After graduating from college, you said that you entered into the school system and started teaching, that's right? Okay. And how many years did you teach?
Well, I came up as home management specialist, and of course, I had had no training in home management, except I was interested in economics. And they, after a couple of years, they gave me a research fellowship, and I was able to get my master's. And I did it in agricultural economics and time and motion study. And both fields I was interested in. Time of motion study because farm women needed help. They had too much to do. And economics because I wanted to stay in extension. And I thought it was sensible to learn more about it. So.
What Valerie's going to ask you, we're following up, your extension, this is where you've got your start in it?
Yeah.
Extension?
Mm-hmm.
And you really ran with it, so we're both interested. Tell us a little bit about that.
Well, I was involved in the state specialist, and I was a research assistant. And I got a fourth foundation grant, went to the University of Chicago. As I recall, I got $2,000. Big money.
In those days?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And then you got your PhD there? Did you tell us about in the early days, what sort of extension were you doing within your community, or how did that, what sort of extension activities were you involved in?
Well, in my early days, we had Boy Scouts organized in our little town, and I kept saying, why can't we have Girl Scouts? And the boy said, well, we just can't. I said, why don't you let me have the name of your organization where you get your information? It did. And I wrote to them and I said, we don't have any Girl Scouts and I can't understand them. And the boys won't let us join the Boy Scouts. What do we do? And they wrote back and said, get a leader. And so we started canvassing the women that we thought would make good leaders, three or four of them. And they all said, no, until we struck our fourth grade teacher. And she said she'd do it. And she was good.
Do you have, were you successful in getting a lot of the girls to be Girl Scouts?
Yeah. We had, I think, 16. 16 or 20. And we stayed together until people graduated from high school. And this woman stayed with us.
As the leader?
Yeah.
That's good.
So, you know, everybody has to help.
Then you continued on. We're sort of interested in the extension because we understand there was some home demonstration women that invested some money in a cooperative house. Do you remember that?
Yeah, I sure do.
Was that a house at Purdue?
Yeah.
Oh, Stan. Which one was that?
Oh, Twin Pines.
Twin Pines?
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Miss Gaddis had a good organization going. She was before me. So when I took over, I was anxious that we continue the strength of the leadership that she developed. And one of the ideas she had that she got from Maud, somebody, I can't remember her last name, but she was a state leader in Oregon. They were built in a co-op house. And Miss Gaddis thought, why couldn't we have them? This was when girls had a hard time getting in this institution and finding a place to live and that sort of thing. Especially if they were poor. And it's true still, I think. But anyway, the women started saving money for this project. Some of them saved a quarter at a time, a year. And in 4 years, we had got $30,000, which was money. And at that time, we had about 50,000 members. And I better check that figure, I'm not sure. But anyway, after they collected the money, I went over to see R.V. Stewart. And I said, well, we've got a project that I need some help with. And he was very genial. R.V. was great to help. And he said, well, what kind of help do you need? I said, well, we got this old house on Waldron Street that we'd like to remodel, and the specialists will draw up plans of how the remodeling should go. And Martha Jo Shelby, who still lives here, helped with the plans. And the other specialist. And we drew up the improvements we'd like to see, and the physical plant helped us do it. And we built that house for $30,000. When I think about it now, it's worth about $250,000.
But isn't it nice it's still there and still being used?
Yeah. Well, I think the girls are going to move.
The extension, were you involved in Purdue's extension, or what was your, you took over from the
cooperative
extension at Purdue?
Yeah.
So you were here on campus?
Yeah.
I see. How did that come about? How did you happen to get,
I don't know. They just wanted me to do it, I didn't. Okay. I mean, you don't know how the university works.
That changes over time.
Yeah.
There you go. Are we on to the prior to assuming the deanship of the School of Home and Economics, you were the Assistant Director of Cooperative Extension Service and State Leader of Home Economics. Could you elaborate more on what you did on the position?
They appointed me Assistant Director and the county agents in a jocular view call me Miss Director. But anyway, they got me in the line of administration. And I think I was very interested in ag economics. See, I took a double major in ag economics, and the boys who were there had influence, and of course the extension people had influence. They offered me the job and I took it. I didn't take anything that looks better.
This is the deanship. You're talking about the deanship?
Of no.
The cooperative, okay.
Assistant director.
Based here at Purdue.
Yeah.
Your office was okay.
And that was when Mr. Hoffman was the director, and he had a lot of national influence. So I was on the national committees. And I saw how Washington worked, so when they offered me a job, I said, no. It's the first time I said no. Mm-hmm. Isn't that funny?
Sometimes that occurs.
Yeah. Yep.
This is part of the impact.
Then next step was the deanship, right, at Home Ec? How did that come about?
Well, everybody had been of the opinion that home economics extension should be a part of the home economics school. And we thought it would give a specialist a better chance to associate with the people who were keeping up on subject matter. And frankly, we thought it would improve the faculty if they had a little exposure to people. So we talked back and forth, and finally came to the conclusion that it was time to do it. So they asked me if I would do it. I said, yes, I would. And I knew it was going to be a hair raiser. But the specialist all pitched in and really made it work.
So you went, how did you come, did they offer you the deanship? How did that come about?
You can be the dean if you go in there, take these people with you.
And we worked it out. That's what came about. And, okay.
And the people that I took wanted to go. And the people in the school wanted new staff members, of course, especially some that were paid by the federal government. So, there's a lot of stuff that goes on.
We ran across this quote that you had, and it said that excellence is goal set by the new dean, and you had put that excellence is a worthwhile goal, whether in organizing a household or writing a thesis. Would you expand on that?
You have to read it to me.
Oh, okay. Excellence is a worthwhile goal, whether in organizing a household or writing a thesis.
Why, absolutely.
And did you want to expand on that?
Doing things well is important. And I think everybody ought to try something hard every year. I do here. Try something hard. If you don't try something hard, you lose your goal. So, I think it's important. Wait, it's too easy to lean back in an easy chair.
Good point.
In your tenure as dean, what were some of the challenges that you had? And I guess.
Well, I think the most important challenge I had was try to get some money in the school, because they always operated on a string and kept. This is the reason you talk to other people, you'll find that I always said, well, look, the women need it. And it was time to get it done. And I hear, if something comes up, I say, why don't we say this has to be a man? See, we got a new director. And I raised the question. I said, what makes us think that running this institution has to be done by a man? They haven't answered it yet.
So, what were some changes that you were trying to make when you were doing?
Well, one of the things I was trying to do is what Saviano was trying to get done now, too. And I just sent him some money to help a little, was to get people involved in how human beings grew up and were educated and worked and lived. And we don't have anything that does that.
Over time?
Yeah, human development. Mm-hmm. If you start with little tiny kids, we had some lunch today. Three little babies, one little baby just bright-eyed, looked around, watching everything, and two little boys. Well, for heaven's sakes, that's where you start. And you keep going for every age group until you get to be 96.
What are some of your ideas for curriculum?
For that sort of a program. Mm-hmm. Oh, of course, I think the care of babies is first step, and kindergarten is second step, and helping kids when they get to be young school age kids want to do well and keep them out of trouble. And then they get a little older for each clubs and white clubs and all kinds of clubs that keeps them interested in doing something well. And when they get to be adults, they still have to have instruction. Any adult that isn't learning, it's paddling.
How big of a faculty did you have for that department?
I don't think I know. I don't think I really know today.
Did it grow?
Yeah.
Your departments grew, you had more.
Of course, it grew. We took in extension people. It grew. But it grew after that. Nutrition has been a fast grower. And, of course, the school cut out some of the things that had been, well, I'd say, traditional, such as textiles, clothing, because the market changed the situation. So, and if we're not a little careful, I think the market's going to take over all kinds of education. Have you noticed that?
Mm-hmm. I have noticed that.
About the students, Valerie and I are interested. How the students, did you interact a lot with them, or what was some of how the change? And
we started the ambassador program. Some of the people who are head of organizations now are some of what we call our ambassadors. They went out to high schools and talked to the students about home economics, why they should come to Purdue and major in home economics, what the opportunities were. And almost all of them wanted to have come to extension work. Have you noticed that?
I guess I've seen that. I've observed that, yeah.
If you notice, then schools are setting up with college students ways to work with informal organizations. Well, that's what extension work is.
There's the outreach.
Yeah.
Yeah, the were you involved in, there was a student chapter, the Home Economics, is that still going in the school, Home Economics, the student chapter of the American Home Economics Association? You have a student chapter, though, don't you, at the school?
I think so.
Okay.
They still have a home economics, that's the smart ones.
This was a quote that you had given. If you're a citizen of Purdue, then you are a citizen of the world.
You are. And it's hard to do. Right now, in this place, I am continually amazed at the fact that people want to ignore the world situation. I keep saying, how come we don't have some groups talking about this? Well, Tom Kelly and I talk about it as well. Tom Kelly is a retired French teacher.
I also have something that says that you've been it's been written that you challenge young women to prepare themselves well and work for social and economic equality. Something you're still doing, challenging.
Yeah, yeah.
Challenging young women.
Still have the same results, too.
The challenge is always there.
Yeah.
Did diversity and gender, is that, Weezy asked a couple questions on that. That has changed over time, hasn't it, within the school? And also about, you were talking earlier about money, but fundraising was something else. That grew when you were the dean?
Yeah. I think one of the reasons that I had some of these opportunities was that I got the women involved in the university. And if you think it was easy, don't. If John Hicks hadn't been here, I'd never made it. John Hicks was a big help.
What sort of involvement did you, are you referring to? I mean, activities or?
We had a conference every June. We'd have 2,000 women come in. We had a 4-H roundup where we had 2,000 kids coming in, so. We always had a bunch of people, and the women have districts organized so that we went out to talk to these various groups about what Purdue was doing, what any new research was available. And, of course, that was people wanted to know this. because the women have taped the women out of the state have been more progressive than the women on the campus, I think.
Interesting.
Because they'll speak up. And you can hardly get women on the campus to speak up. I started this campaign to get more women on the board of trustees. I felt we needed them. And boy, that was a rough road. Nobody wanted to talk to me about it.
Well, they've always had to have one, but now they've gotten in recent appointments.
Yeah, they got one or two more. But I told the past presidents, I said, look, this is crazy. You women are competent women. You're educated women. Why don't you speak up? You don't have to have a fight. All you have to say is, why aren't there more women on the board of trustees?
Well, there are recent appointments.
Another thing the school has been involved with is the consumer education. In 1965, Esther Peterson, Special Assistant to President Johnson for Consumer Affairs, visited Purdue as part of the National Extension Homemakers Council meeting. Any thoughts on her visit or the conference?
Who's visit?
Esther Peterson.
Oh, yeah. She's a great girl. Oh, she came and talked up a storm and got everybody interested. I don't know what's happened since, but of course consumerism has taken over.
Did you get to meet her personally?
Oh, yeah. I knew her. She's very vivacious, talking. She could talk faster than I could.
Any words of wisdom that she left me, or?
Well, the only words that I remember are that she thought that women ought to get in business and do something.
Yeah. Is she still alive?
I'm not sure whether she is or not. I think not, probably.
Some of what, both Valerie and I, in preparation for this, as you know, we do some research and things, and that was one of the things that caught our eye with the picture. But I'm not too sure. You don't hear anything about her. But she had a big, important job in those days in the 60s to be, a special assistant to Johnson for Consumer Affairs.
Yeah. And Johnson was a bigger friend to women than the women knew. Because, politics got in the way.
So, another item is that you mentioned that consumers need more educational material on buying and storage. Do you think that's happened?
Well, we had a girl that went out to California, and she was a Purdue grad, and she tried to get jobs at various places, and nothing happened. So she finally got a small office space and hung out the shingle that she was a specialist in reading consumer contracts. And as far as I know, she's still out there making
the shingle is still hung up, right?
Shingle is still out. But home economics lends itself to many different vocations. It has to today because consumerism is, you can get a job telling people how to manage their money if you know how. Or you can tell them how to repair their automobile.
During your tenure, was there a development office, and how successful was that?
Our development office was nothing to our ambassadors for our development people. When I say ambassadors, I mean the students, senior students. Let's see, and Jamie Street was our first one. And she's now a doctor in Indianapolis for some firm. And she went all over the state talking to students about why they should come to Purdue. Then, the girl that runs up, the designer niche. Marty, she was a good one, and she is on some board that the university has now. So all of those girls, they're leaders, are important. Annie Watts, do you know Annie? Well, Annie promotes all kinds of new food products. And she talks up a storm. And what's the girl that ran for office? She didn't get it, but I voted for her. What was her name? Bentley.
A local person?
Yeah. She's quite a big woman. I can't think of something.
We can put editing. Well, did they have, was there a development office in the school like the schools have now? The library has in Judy Shoemaker?
No, there wasn't. We didn't have.
Did contributors, they didn't contribute, so it was a lot different than it is today.
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
So if anybody wanted to give us money, they came in and put it down on the team's desk.